So thank you all for coming. I'm going to give you a short introduction to deep learning today. So first of all, the content of my talk. I will give you a short motivation why you should care about deep learning, why you should apply it, what you actually need it for. Then I will give you a definition. And then I will start with simple linear models and motivate the ideas behind deep learning and why people came up with deep learning. What problem does it solve that you cannot solve with simple linear models? Next, I will go over the main ingredients to model deep learning, like which are the parts that you can change in deep learning, what makes a deep learning model. And in the end, I will give you a short summary how you can get started with deep learning yourself. So why should you care about deep learning? I think the main reason you should care is because for many problems, you basically have to use deep learning if you want to be competitive. Everything has to do with images, for example, image classification, translation, or also speech synthesis. The second important reason why you should care about deep learning is that the tools are very versatile. You can use it for many different things. You can just make your existing statistical models faster with very large linear models. You can do inference probabilistic graphical models. You can do particle simulations and many other things that became possible through deep learning tools. So the goals of my talk are that you should understand the motivation behind deep learning, that you should know enough theory to understand very simple deep learning models, and you're also able to build them yourself using Keras, which is a very popular Python library for creating artificial neural networks. So what is deep learning? It's a very technical definition, so we go through it step by step. It's a class of machine learning methods that rely on layers of nonlinear computation and that are optimized by a stochastic gradient descent. But the really important parts are that we have something nonlinear and we have multiple layers of that. And stochastic gradient descent is an optimization method. I'll explain to you later in detail, but the importance is you only use it if you have a very large amount of data. So this sounds really complicated, so we'll start with simple linear models and go on from there. Let's say, for example, you have a house and you want to predict the price of the house. So your house is 120 square meters of living space, you have 200 square meters of garden, and you have one garage. If a simple linear model would look something like this. You have coefficients, and the coefficients are basically unit prices. For each of you have the three inputs, the living space, the garden size, and how many garages your house has. And for each of these things, you have a unit price. And if you want to predict, if you already know the coefficients and you want just to know how much your house will sell for, then you multiply all your input values with the respective coefficients and add the so-called bias term, which is something like a base price. Even the cheapest house will cost you at least 10,000 euros. And in the end, you get your price. But basically what this does is it's just a weighted sum of the inputs plus some constant. One of the simplest models you can imagine. So how do you choose the coefficients? Luckily for us, there is an area called econometrics, and econometrics basically works mostly with linear models. So there are lots of very nice theorems, and mathematicians have found out a lot about these models, and there's a very nice formula how you get the coefficients. And normally, you minimize the squared difference. So you want your housing prices to be as close to the actual price they sold for as possible. This also implies you need to have at least some data where you know the answers. You need to have some historical data. You have a list of houses, how large the house is, how large the garden is, how many garages it has, and how much it actually sold for. You need this data to calculate the coefficients. So what are the limits of this model? The main limit is the output is always a single unconstrained real number. So you always get a single number. And it's a number. And the solution to that, that very hard limit, are generalized linear models. But why would you not be happy with a single number? Let me give you an example. Let's say you are doing credit scoring. That means you have somebody applies for a loan at a bank, that uses a data scientist. You need to tell the bank should they loan money to this person or not. And of course, if the let's say you put this into a linear model, the answer is 5. What do? Like 5 is in the answer to the question you asked. The answer ideally should be a yes or no. So if you want to have a different output, there is a very nice solution that mathematicians came up with, and it's called link functions. So basically you train a linear model, and in the end you just append a function. So in our case, we want to have a yes or no. A nice way to do this is to get a number between 0 and 1. 0 means, for example, do not loan money to this person at all, and 1 means, yes, loan money to this person, he will pay you back definitely. There's basically probability that you get paid back. And the way to do this is to have the same linear model you had before, but in the end, you put it through a function that squashes all the values between 0 and 1. So, how can you make your task at hand, how can you solve tasks with GLMs? The answer is simple. You just need to find the right link function for the output you want to have. When you want to have output 0 or 1, you use this logistic link function. And there are many extensions to this, many different link functions that you can adapt to basically all distributions. Let's say you want to have Poisson distributions output, there's a link function for that. And sometimes you also want to have multiple outputs, like mean and variance. And the way you solve this, you just have two models. One outputs the mean, and one outputs the variance. And you can have, they're completely independent with different link functions, but this way you can solve most problems. So, how would you choose the coefficients for that? The answer is you minimize the log likelihood. What is the log likelihood? The log likelihood is basically the probability of your training data. As we said before, we have all these houses, and we have historic prices of the houses, and how large the houses were, how much garden was included, how much garages. And you want basically the predictions of your model be very likely in the world of your historic data. And you optimize this numerically. And just to summarize, basically the link function forces us to use log likelihood, which makes it a bit of a black box model. It's not really a black box, but many theorems that hold for simple linear models do no longer hold. For example, you don't have a unit price anymore. When you come back to the credit scoring, there is no unit price for age. You can say, is age something that makes you more likely to loan money to this person, or less likely? Or how does age compare to income? Like 1 year of additional age is equivalent to like 500 euros of income, but there is no unit price anymore, which makes it a bit harder to interpret, but still very transparent. But it's also a bit harder to use because, of course, you need to optimize numerically. So what are the limits of GLMs? The problem is you want to have identical outputs when inputs have nothing in common, like these two dog pictures. There is no obvious way. How can you input these pixels into your GLM and the model immediately sees all these inputs are very similar? They both must be dogs. Because the pictures don't have anything in common except maybe the background color. And the root of all these limitations is all these models are based on a weighted sum of the inputs. That's when we come back to the credit scoring. The model, for example, could not understand that a very low age is bad and a very high age is bad. You probably don't want to loan money to an 18-year-old and you don't want to loan money to a 90-year-old because neither of them will probably pay you back. But there's some kind of a golden middle, but the model will understand this because it's one coefficient and either age is something good or bad. So there's one very popular example, and it's the XOR function. XOR function is a computer science function. Basically, if you input the same thing two times, you get a 0. If you input different things, you get a 1. It's a very simple function, but you cannot learn this with a linear model without doing lots of pre-processing and applying some tricks. So how can you improve GLMs? First of all, In deep learning terms, the GLM with the logic link function is perceptual. You will see there are always at least two terms for everything, because one term is a mathematician's term, one term is the computer scientist, so data scientist's term. the perceptor is basically a chill M with the logic in the function. And the way it works, illustrated this again, is just you create a weighted sum of inputs, you put it through a nonlinear function, in our case logic link function, and you get another number. And the solution to our problems is to stack these types of models. We don't want a single model, we have many of these models in order to repeatedly apply them. So how does this look? This is a so-called multi-layer perceptron. You have in the first layer, you don't have a single GLM, but you have three GLMs. So what you do is you create three weighted sums of the inputs with different coefficients, with different so-called unit prices. Then you put each of the numbers to this non-linear activation function. Activation function, again, another term for link function. And you get three different numbers. And normally would be finished. You already have your outputs. But in deep learning, or especially for the multi-layer perceptron, you use these outputs as the input to the next layer. And do exactly the same thing again. You have these three inputs, and you create two weighted sums. It could also be more weighted sums without than just two. But it's two weighted sums, you put them through a non-linearity, and you again get two output numbers. And that's why it's called deep learning. Because you don't have a single layer, it's not just weighted sum activation function, it's weighted sums activation function, and again weighted sums activation function, and so on. That's where the name deep comes from. So this is what we just called feed forward layers. What that means is that at each layer, we just multiply x with a weight matrix, apply the nonlinear activation function, and we get our output of this layer, which is then fed again into the input of the next layer. At the bottom you can see how this is actually calculated. The input, for example, is x1 to x3. You multiply it with each column of your weight matrix. You get two numbers, you put them to a logic function, and then you have your output, y1 and y2. And do this over and over again, and that's the basic building block of deep learning. This is the most fundamental thing in deep learning. Almost everything else that we read about is based on this. So what do we actually use this for? In what you would use it for is maybe classification. For example, two very popular applications are, for example, fraud detection or churn rate prediction. Churn rate prediction is when you want to forecast which customers are going to leave you soon, because they're not actually using your product anymore, maybe. And why would you use it? Because it can do automatic feature detection. The linear model sees every single input as either good or bad. So high age is good or high age is bad. Earning a lot of money is good or earning a lot of money is bad. But what this type of model can do, it can do some sort of feature detection. It can see that age maybe isn't that important, that there's a golden middle. It can also see things like if these three things are high, then it's bad, and if these three things are good, if these three things are high, then that's good, then you should loan money for a person. And at least in theory, they are universal approximators. That means they can approximate any function to an arbitrary degree, but only in theory. That's still a very nice property to have. So how would you choose the coefficients for a model like this? You would just minimize some loss function. Loss function is something very general. It's just some performance metric that you can optimize nicely. For example, again, the squared difference. Could be the same as in the housing price example at the beginning. You just want to minimize the square difference between your predicted housing price and the actual housing price you know from your historic data. And you optimize with stochastic gradient descent. But more than the next slide. First, I want to summarize. Basically, these multiple layers, they make the model very flexible. Flexible, you can learn new stuff like the XOR function. But also, norm statistics don't really apply to this anymore. Give much fewer guarantees than you have with these GLMs, with these generalized linear models. So, what is stochastic gradient descent? It is very simple. This is basically a technique made for very large data sets. What you do is you create your model, and all the coefficients or the unit prices, so to say, are just some random number. And then you take a few of your historic housing prices and you let the model predict the housing prices. In the end, you compare them. You compare what has the model predicted and what was the actual price the house sold for. And because you initialize everything at random, there will probably be a very large difference. But what you do next is you tune all the coefficients, you move all these so-called unit prices, you move them into all the coefficients, you move them a little bit in a way that the average deviation, or the average loss reduces for these few houses, let's say for these five houses. So now the model just got a little bit better, at least for these five samples. And you do it again, you take the next five houses from your historic Excel spreadsheet, and you again you calculate the loss, and then you tune all the coefficients a little bit in a way that the average loss for these only these five houses decreases. And do this over and over again, and you constantly make your model better. And after some time, this converges to a pretty good model normally, if you did everything correctly. Okay, we have a short coding example. It's a very simple example because it should just give you an idea how you would build a model like this. So, first of all, what we'll do is we'll basically build a very simple model that can learn the XOR function. First of all, you need to import all the modules you want to use from Keras, which is the library I'm going to use for all my code samples. You need to load the data, we'll reload the data, just generate it. It's exactly the XOR examples I showed you before. Basically, if the two values are the same, the output is zero. But if they're different, like 1, 0, then the output is 1. We want to build a model that can learn this. So the first thing we need to do is we basically need to prepare the data. We need to split it into the inputs, this is the x, and the output we want to produce, which is y. And then let's build our first model. This is the simple perceptor. This will not be able to, probably not be able to learn the XOR function. The way you build a model in Keras is you first need to decide if you're going to use the sequential API or the functional API. We use the sequential API. So you start building the model by doing this. You just instantiate a new sequential model. And then you just add one layer on top of another. This is the simplest way to build deep learning models. These so-called dense layers is basically just a weighted sum of all the outputs of the previous layer. We say we want a single output, which in the end should be 0, 1, and we have two inputs. So either 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1. And the activation is a sigma. Sigma is again another term for the logistic link function. Or at least a very similar function. It also does exactly the same thing. It squashes all the values between 0 and 1. And we'll interpret it like this. If it's lower than 0.5, it will be 0. If it's higher than 0.5, it will be 1. And then, after we've finished building our simple model, we compile the model. We need to tell it what optimizer to use. We use standard stochastic gradient descent. As loss, we use binary cross entropy. You can read about that at home. This is basically the loss to use if you have a binary classification problem. If you want, then only have two classes, in our case 0 and 1, you will almost always use this loss. And metrics, the metrics we're interested in is the accuracy. Metrics doesn't really do anything, except it prints these metrics for us. Keras will automatically calculate the accuracy. We will automatically calculate the accuracy after a few samples, and we can inspect the model and see how it improves. Now we fit the model, we take it the x data, the x, y, we tell it to choose a batch size of 1. Batch size 1 basically means that it should always look at a single sample from our training data set, calculate the loss, then tune the coefficients. Before my example, we always look at 5 houses at the same time. Now we only look at 1 of these rows of the matrix. Epochs means how often do we feed in our data. Because only 4 examples, that's not that much, we're going to reuse every row 1,000 times. And verbose 1 means that we want to see how the training is going. You can see in the beginning it's at 75%, but in the end, it basically goes down to 0.5 because the model tries to learn a function it cannot learn. And we see it doesn't work. But here comes the multilayer perceptron. It's the same as before, the only difference is this line. We have this dense layer in the middle, which has 8 units, with an output of 8 units, which are input in the first layer. The input is again of size 2, and it has a new activation function called tangens hyperbolicals. What this activation function does, it does almost the same as sigmoid, but it squashes numbers not between 0 and 1, but between minus 1 and 1. And for many problems, this works much better. What we do next is we train again the model. You can see the beginning is already at 50% accuracy, it goes up to 75, it goes down to 50%, but after some time it converges until it gets every single training sample correct. Because it can learn the XOR function because it has an additional layer. The important thing about this is how to build the model and not. Use a very simple data set so you can focus on that. Okay. So what are the ingredients of neural network? What can actually vary? Where do research scientists publish their papers? The first thing you can vary is the input, the way you feed your data into the network. The next thing is the architecture. This is probably the most interesting part, because until now we only have the so-called feed-forward layers. We read everything on the previous layer and generate the output based on that. But of course, you can have more interesting types of layers, but more on that later. Then, also activation functions. You already seen a few, sigmoid, tangens hyperbolicals, but there are also a few others that you should be aware of. And of course, the loss. Sometimes, for some tasks, it's important to have a very smart loss, so you need to be very thoughtful with the training objective. For most tasks, you will use a few standard loss functions. And of course, the optimizer. There are different types of optimizers, but most of them are almost all of the optimizers in this common Python packages, they are based on the stochastic gradient descent. And all more advanced optimizers do is they remember how they tweak the coefficients the last few times. And they see if they're always tweaking a variable in the same direction, then it probably needs to go a lot further in the same direction. But that's some of the input. The first case where we had, most of the time you just have lots of, you just have some independent numbers. It's just a vector of numbers. They don't really belong together. It's just your inputs. But for some data sets, for example, images, you have more structured input. It's not just random numbers, but for example, you have pixel values. The pixels mean something. They are arranged in a grid, and it's very important that you do not lose this information. The second challenge of inputting data into neural networks is when you have categorical values. Like for example, you want to input a country, or you want to input a movie genre. And the solution to that is embeddings. But more on that later. Then some of the tensors. So what is a tensor? Basically, some types of data as a most popularly images, you don't want to put all the pixels in a very long vector and input it like that. But you want to keep the structure, you want to know that this pixel is surrounded by these other 4 pixels and so on. So what do we do in computer science? In computer science, we just make an array. An array that's 128 times 128 times 3. Like 128 pixels in one dimension, 128 pixels in the other dimension, and 3 color chains. So that we need. And the way you do this, or what the mathematician's term for something like this is tensor. Basically, you already know a scalar, which is just a number. The mathematicians call it scalar. Then you might know a vector, which is just some numbers on top of each other, which is called a vector. You might know a matrix, which is basically a rectangle of numbers. And the umbrella term for this is tensor. It's basically the mathematician's term for array. And you can also, and as you see, it only goes into 2 dimensions. Above that, you might call it a tensor. For example, our image array would be a 3-dimensional tensor. And what are embeddings? These embeddings are the deep learning solution to input the categorical data. What you will do for a linear model, you use one-hot encoding. One-hot encoding means, as you can see, let's say you want to input an adventure movie, then you have this 100 vector. Action movie 010, and so on. So basically you have a very long vector with lots of zeros, and each of the spots is exactly one of the spots is one. It's like an indicator. If this is one, it's an action movie. If this is one, it's an adventure movie, and so on. But the problem with that is you basically assume that these movies are all completely different. And when you have a new genre, you need to retrain your whole model. And the solution are embeddings. Because with embeddings, what you do is you want to represent everything through a set of shared factors. For example, you want to represent a movie. Normally, let's say your model contains 5,000 movies, you have 5,000 inputs, you're all zero except a single one, which indicates which movie you want to input. What is a lot smarter is if you would have some shared factors. For example, like each of the factors could be something like how much action does the movie contain, how much adventure does it contain, how much romance, how much comedy, and so on. So similar movies, like two Harry Potter movies, they would probably have very similar embeddings. While Die Hard would have very different embeddings than Harry Potter movies. So you could already encode that in your input. And we're going to build a very simple model again in Keras. The way it works is, for each movie, for each unit, you have like three factors. For example, the first factor could be like how much violence is in the movie. The second one could be how much comedy is in the movie, and the last one, how much magic is in the movie. And for the user, we have all three factors, and the first factor represents how much does this user like violent movies, how much does he like comedic movies, and how much does he like magic movies. And then we have in the blue boxes, we have two numbers, it's called biases, because like if it would only have these two factors, then it would say, oh, this is a comedic movie, this user likes comedic movies, he likes this movie. But some movies just suck, they're just bad. Like in our case, I'm not sure it's really a bad movie, but it's minus one. So on average, it's rated one star below all the other movies. And we have the same thing for the user, because like some users, they give five stars to every movie. And this guy, for example, he gives on average like half a star more to each movie than the average user. And if you now want to calculate how much this user would like the Harry Potter movie, you multiply the factors with each other, and you add the two biases, and you get a rating of 3.5 stars. And it was this would tell you that this user would probably give the movie 3.5 stars. And we also did a Keras implementation of that. Again, we import all the stuff we need from Keras, and now we load the data. This time it's a CSV file. And you can see the first column of the CSV file is the user ID, and the movie ID, and then the rating. Rating tells us this user rated this movie with 5 stars. And you have a timestamp when the user watched the movie, but we're going to ignore that for now. Now we need to pre-process the data. First thing we do is we read all the movie titles from the CSV file because we want to be able to see what the model does. So what these four lines basically do is they load all the movie names into a dictionary. Like the movie with the ID 1 is Toy Story, with the ID 2 it's Jumanji, with 3 it's Grumpy Old Man. The next 8 lines, what they do is the data set gives each user an ID and each movie an ID. And we start their IDs with 1, but they need to start with 0 because of the rating index. So what these 8 lines do is they replace the ID 1 with 0, 2 with 1, 3 with 2, and so on. They shift in the 1 down. Next, what we do is we split our data set. We split it in 2. We want the training data set and test data set. The reason is you need to be careful with the learning models, they might just be able to learn your whole data set by heart. It looks really good when you apply it to new data or new moves and new users, it doesn't work at all. So we need to keep some data secret from the model. Next, we build the model. This model is a bit more complicated because we're using the function API of Keras. which is also a lot more powerful. The way you start is, the first thing we need to decide on is how many factors do we want. We want 32 factors. Then we define two inputs. We define the user input and the mover input. The shape tells Keras this is a single number. We input a single user ID or a single movie ID, the integers, and we also give them a name. Next, we create the embeddings. The way this works is we define an embedding function. We tell it for each user we want the 32 factors, and we always want the embedding of a single user. When you're working with words or other data, you might want always the embeddings of the whole sentence. In our case, we always want the embedding of a single user. And this embedding regularizer, what it does is it basically the goal of this is we want to keep the factors of the model very small. We don't want the factors to be -10,000, +10,000. We want to keep them around zero, like +10. Otherwise, you can get numerical problems. And then, after we define the embedding, we say we want the embedding of this input we just defined. This input is basically a placeholder. We basically create a placeholder for all the inputs, and later on, when you finish building the model, you can just feed these placeholders in, and it tells you basically the output of all the layers. Next, we do exactly the same thing, but for the biases. There might be a more elegant way, but what I did is I just create an embedding of size 1, and this again basically this looks up single number for each user. Each user has its own bias, and each movie has its own bias. What we do next is exactly what we did before. We do the dot product of the embedding of the user and the embedding of the movie. Then we add the bias of the user, then we add the bias of the movie, and then we have our result. But because all the inputs, because the inputs have more dimensions than we want, they're basically the arrays that have dimensions that have size 1. So basically we would need to index them with 0, 0, but that doesn't make sense. They're basically spurious dimensions. What flatten does is it throws away all the dimensions, gives a single vector. In our case, we only have a single number, so this doesn't really change anything. Next, we build the model. For the function API, we build the model in the end. We basically tell it in an array what are my inputs, and then you tell it what is my output. Or this could also be an array and you have multiple outputs. And in the end, you compile the model, use the Adam optimizer, which is the most commonly used optimizer, because it works very well for a wide variety of problems. And the loss is the so-called mean squared error, the same thing as with the housing crisis before. Then what we do is we fit the model. We input the training data, batch size 64. We train for 5 epochs, so we go over the whole data set 5 times. Verbose 1 is for the sake of us seeing what the training routine does. And the validation data tells the model to evaluate the model also on data it does not use for training. So this data it has never seen. You can actually see how good the model perform for an unknown user or an unknown movie. So we train the model, and after 5 epochs, we have a loss of 0.77. And if you're like me, you don't know what that means. Is the model good? Is it bad? So we can actually look at the model and see how does it rate all the movies. Because you want now to analyze what does the movie can tell you what can the model tell us about all the movies. The way we do this, we select the 1,000 most rated movies, because we don't want to have movies that are only rated by 2 people. And then we create this one reason why we use the functional API. You can just alter the model afterwards, and we just create a mini model that gives us the bias for a movie. And as I told you before, the bias tells us how does this movie compare to all the other movies. Is it rated higher on average than other movies, or is it rated lower on average than other movies? What we can do is we can sort all the movies by the biases, and we get a feeling for what are the, in general, highest rated movies. You can see the highest rated movies are Sixth Sense, Star Wars Episode 4, brings the Lost Ark, Shawshank Redemption, The Godfather, Schindler's List. These are all very critically acclaimed movies. And we can also get one of the worst movies. Honestly, I've not seen any of these movies, and it's a good thing. But yeah, these are the worst movies according to the world. You can also look at single factors. Some of these factors, you can see what the model is doing. Like, we look, let's look at the 13th factor, and these are the movies that have a very high on this factor. You can see these are like children's fairy tale stories, Disney movies, something like this. You can also look at factor 14. These are more like big trashy action movies, Godzilla or Independence Day, Meet from Back and Forth. But not all, of course, I looked at the movie factors beforehand and then it chose those where you can actually see something. Some of them are just random and you don't really know what they should represent. But what you can also do, what's very nice, you can do a principal component analysis on this and you get much, even I think, even nicer factors where you can, where the movies are grouped together, but even nicer than here. But now back to our presentation. Okay, let's come to the architecture. Because the first thing we want to talk about are activation functions. It's really important that you have activation functions because they are non-linear and they make them more powerful. But it's not that important which one to choose. You always try around which one works, but there are only a few that we actually use. Next are the connectivity patterns. For example, a layer might not be able to see the outer of all the previous layers, not only the last layer. But there are many different connectivity patterns. I will show you a few in the next slides. First, activation functions. The first one you already know is a logic activation function, or sigmoid. It basically squashes down between 0 and 1, it's like the S shape. That's numbers above 6 are basically 1, and below minus 6 are basically 0, and between them is S shape. Pangas hyperbolicus, it's exactly the same, but with minus 1 and 1. And for some tasks, this works better. The next one is often used for image tasks, it's called ReLU. It's the simplest activation function. What it does is, it looks at the number, if the number is negative, it sets it to 0, if it's positive, it gives the number a null. So you get, from your perspective, you get something like this. And then the last important activation function is softmax. What this does is, it's very similar to the sigmoid activation function, as it squashes all the values between 0 and 1. But additionally, it guarantees you that they also sum to 1. This is very nice for multi-class classification problems, because you get, for example, you have 10 different classes, then you get 10 numbers, and they're all between 0 and 1, and they sum to 1, like a probability measure. So we will start, I will show you a few examples of more advanced connectivity patterns. Image processing. Means the two connectivity patterns we're going to talk about are convolutions and pooling. But first, what is the idea behind these two layers? This idea is when you're working with images, most of the time, let's say you are classifying animals. When you have this picture of the bird is not on the whole picture, but it's only on part of the picture, you have some background and also stuff you don't care about. That's the locality. And the second thing is the translation invariance. If you're building an image classification problem, you don't care if is the bird on the top left, on the right, in the middle, is it on the screen. You only want to know, is there a bird or not? So the way this works is about convolutional layers. You have a very, very small neural network that only sees these nine outputs of the previous layer. And what it does is, it only looks at those and generates a single number. And you apply the same network to each part of the image. And the idea behind it is that, let's say you want to, this network detects cats. You, like a cat in the top left looks exactly the same as a cat in the bottom right corner. It doesn't matter where the cat is, the cat detector should still see the cat as a cat. You don't want to learn the same thing for each location of the image. So, I have a short, I think you can illustrate this really well in Excel. What I did is, I have this grayscale image of number 4, and I just put all some condition formatting, so when the number is when the pixel value is 1, it's white, when it's 0, it's black, and gray in between. And we have a simple convolution filter. The way it works is, we have these 9 numbers, and we multiply these 9 numbers with a square on the left side, and it outputs a single number. In our case, this would be a 1. And you do this for each 3x3 square on the left side. And you get on the right side, it's basically an image that is white everywhere where the filter matches. In our case, it's an upper edge filter. Because it wants these values to be as low as possible, the values in the middle be as high as possible, and it doesn't care about the values below. And you can just by changing the numbers, you get a different edge detector. For example, let's say you want to detect right edges. What you do, or left edges, you set this to -1, this to 1, and this to 0. So we want the left part of the square to be very low. So we want it to be 0, but the middle part to be have a very large value, ideally 1, and we don't care about the right part. You can see on the right, all the left edges are highlighted. And what and neural networks actually learn these edge filters by themselves on the lowest layer. So we would normally not use a single filter, but something like 32 filters, and we learn left edges, right edges, diagonals, and so on. In the next layer, they will basically work with multiple of these images, and then they will combine them. For example, you have the right edge, the diagonal, the left edge, diagonal, and the upper edge, then this is like a quarter circle. So you will have something like a quarter circle detector maybe. And the next one, the next important layer is called pooling layer. It's really simple. It's about this translation variance. You don't really care exactly where things are. They should be, you just want to roughly know where they are. So what you do is you use called max pooling. That's also because when you have like an edge, the edge is not like there and then it's gone. But because all these little squares overlap, you sometimes get like a white pixel because the edge is really there, and then you get also the same thing immediately adjacent to the first white pixel. So what you do is you use pooling layers. So what they do is you cut the picture to little squares, and just take the maximum of each square. This also reduces the size of the picture, the size of your data, so it computer has much less work to do. And now with an example with image classification, it's like the example when you're looking for neural network tutorials, deep learning tutorials, everybody will use this example. So will I. Again, we import all the Keras stuff in for the example, then we load the data. This is really easy because so many people are using this data set, it's directly built into Keras. You can just do anything to get the data. And it's again a NumPy array, and the training data is 60,000 pictures, and they're 28 times 28 pixels, and they're grayscale. Just to give you an idea how these pictures look, this is for example a 5. Like our model should see this picture and output 5. That's what we want to accomplish. Here's a 0, and here is the 4 you saw before. So how would you build a model to do it? First, you need to pre-process the data. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to normalize the data because it makes it easier for the model to train. We don't want values between 0 and 255, but between 0 and 1. 1 is white, 0 is black. And everything between is gray. Then we need to add a color channel. The reason is almost all the image processing functionality is based on color pictures, and color pictures have 3 color channels. So what we do is we add a dummy color channel. It doesn't change the data, it just changes how we would access the array in this indices. And the Y values, which is a ground truth, like the Y is just a huge factor with 0, 1, 9, 4, and so on. We don't need to do anything. So let's build the model. We use again the sequential API because it's much simpler. And now what you do is you add a convolution, you create a sequential model, and you add the first filter. It's a convolutional 2D filter, 2D because you're working with two dimensions because it's pictures. You would use 1D for text maybe, or 3D for MRI images that are three dimensions, but we use two dimensions. Then we want 32 of these edge detectors. The kernel size is 3 times 3, that means it always looks at 3 times 3 squares. The activation is ReLU. ReLU is again this function that sets all the negative numbers to 0 and all the positive, it leaves all the positive numbers unchanged. And the input shape is 28 times 28 with one color channel. You only need the input shape for the first layer. And then we add a max pooling layer. Max pooling cuts the picture into lots of 2 times 2 squares and always takes the maximum value of each channel of that. And then we do the same thing 2 additional times. And after that, we basically have a very, very small image with 32 color channels. So really color channels anymore, but more like detected edges or like very high level features. Because the first layer has edges, the second layer has more like half circles and so on, and this layer already has very large features. Because you can also see more, because this max pooling basically reduces the size, so each 3 times 3 square actually covers more space on the original image. What we do next, we flatten the image. Flatten means we throw away all the spatial information. We don't want to see the picture anymore, but just as a long vector of numbers. And then we have these 2 feed forward layers. This is exactly like a multi-layer perceptron that's plugged on in the end. And finally, we use softmax of size 10, which means we want 10 numbers. They're all between 0 and 1, or they sum to 1. So this is the probability that the first number is the probability that it's a 0, the second number is the probability that it's a 1, the third number is the probability that it's a 2, and so on. And then we again compile the model. We use the Adam optimizer with the default settings. The loss is categorically sparse, categorically cross entropy, which is the default loss you use for multi-class classification. I'm going to explain it here, but it's not very complicated. And now we train the model with batch set of 32, 3D blocks, and we can use validation data. And we can see that after the 3D blocks, we have an accuracy of 98%. Okay. So basically, what are losses? Losses are just some functions describe how well does the output of your model fit the desired output. The housing price would basically tell you how close is the predicted price to the price you want to see. Maybe you don't care if the price is too high, only if it's too low. Your loss function should reflect that. One example is then the squared loss. So how can you get started with deep learning? The first thing you should learn about some basic concepts, which you already did. So you're already at step 2, which is you should choose a framework with which to work, and then you should do some tutorials. Which framework should you choose? I really recommend you Keras. At least in the beginning, you should definitely use Keras because it's extremely simple. It's a very well-designed API. It's also based on TensorFlow. That means you can also take advantage of some more advanced functionality if you want to put your model online and deploy it. And there are lots of tutorials for it. The only disadvantage is it's a bit limited in what you can do. Like, for example, the more advanced models like text generation and so on, they are maybe difficult to implement. But almost everything that has to do with pictures works very well in Keras. The next framework I can recommend you is, like after you finish with playing around with Keras, you might choose PyTorch. It's also relatively simple and has a well-designed API. It's basically, if you have ever used NumPy, it's exactly like NumPy, but on the GPU, and it allows you to train the model. But all the operators are basically the same. And it supports also highly dynamic networks, which is important if you want to like use the coolest and really new models, then you should definitely use PyTorch. And the only disadvantage is that it's still in beta, that means there are fewer tutorials, and in general the API could change. And last but not least, TensorFlow. The biggest advantage of TensorFlow is everybody is using it because it was the first one, and it has lots of resources, tutorials, pre-built models. But the disadvantage is it has a very complex and very bad design. It's the worst. It's like how not this. For example, all the examples use the wrong way to feed in data because the right way would require like 100 lines of boilerplate code. PyTorch is the correct thing by default. Yeah. And also, it does not support highly dynamic networks. Google itself has some highly dynamic networks, like for parsing sentences and so on, but you need to spend half a year writing C++ code to do what you can do in PyTorch immediately. The biggest advantage is it's production ready. That means if you're going to use deep learning at your company, you will probably use TensorFlow because there's lots of functionality for hot swapping models, or just deploying models, very nice metrics, and so on. And also, if you are rich and have money for like more than 8 GPUs, it works very well across multiple machines. Yeah. And the best tutorial resources, in my opinion, are fast.ai. A lot of the stuff you see today I've got from there. It's in my opinion one of the best tutorials on deep learning because it's very practically oriented. They show you how to set up your machine and so on. Suppose if you want to upgrade your machine, what components to buy. And the second one is the framework's official documentations. Especially for TensorFlow and PyTorch, they have very nice examples. They have very, very simple models. They have intermediate models, more complex models, and they have really, really advanced models. And of course, just Google it. Most of these students are blogging about it, so you'll find lots of good tutorials online. So, thank you for your attention, and does anyone have questions? How I found out that 32 factors work?
Yeah, so you define it as just the complexity of your model, or
there is no real theory around deep learning right now. Not enough. So most of these things, you just try them out.
Exactly.
What works, what doesn't.
So the number of factors is just the level of complexity of your model.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
But apparently, I also tried much larger numbers. I tried 64, 128, okay. But it doesn't improve. So I stayed at 32.
It actually completely complements your question. So I guess that the more data you have, the more complex you can make your model. You can afford a more complex model with more data.
Generally, yes, yeah. But there are also there are factors that nobody, in general, this is true, but sometimes, depending on how you build your model, you can have very complex models with not that much data. It really depends on the model.
But do you have something like a rule of thumb, just to get a feeling of how complex can I make my model if I have n is equal to a certain number of data?
You need to try it out for your specific task. Most of the things you really need to try out, and there's no theory behind it, but normally you basically use a model that already exists, and you try to apply it to your model, and you try it. For example, with these embeddings, normally there are a few parameters you can tune very easily. For example, let's say you want to use the same model I just showed you for movies, you want to use it for food and people. You would basically use the same model I just showed you, and you would try to change the number of factors. And you would play around, and you might add a few layers on top of the end and see if it improves. Yeah. You would basically always start with a model you know that already works for some problem. Yes?
What's the typical way to calculate these things? With the CPU or GPU?
GPU. You need, for the simple tutorials, you might not need a GPU, But if you're serious about it, you need to have a GPU that's like at least 100 times faster.
How long needs this to get the first result?
It depends on the model, of course. Mm. But normally when you have a fast GPU, like the most complex models after a few hours. But like the models here that you saw with the movies, like it's like a minute on a fast GPU. You can also scale them across multiple GPUs if you want to train larger models. Yes?
You mentioned like highly dynamic networks. Yes. What does it mean?
Highly dynamic means like right now we have this fixed structure, like images this size, we apply these layers on top of it, and basically you know the size ahead of time. But one example is, for example, it's called recursive neural networks. It's, you have a sentence, and you can represent the sentence in the form of a tree. The sentence always has a different length, and the path tree also always looks different. So you need to dynamically decide, for each sentence you need to decide which words are next to each other, which words you need to combine. Because you can have like if, else, and so on. Normally you don't have if, else, you need to kind of cheat and multiply things with one or zero. With high dynamic, you can basically change the network each round.
So kind of not just stacking layers on top, but also have some bit of logic in there.
Exactly, yes. Especially when you want to apply like computer science logic, like if, then, if, else, switch, and so on, combined with the networks. That's when you have high dynamic networks.